Okay, very good. Well, thank you all for coming. Let me first make a disclaimer. I now realize that this talk is in the series of emerging market issues, but any connection between Greece and emerging markets is purely coincidental. And I wouldn't want to be to be associated with branding Greece in that way. I should also say that Albert already mentioned, in fact, that my Greek Cypriot background, and looking at that Athenian owl there reminds me of my school years when I went to what was then known, it's still known actually, like that Pan Cyprian Gymnasium. It was known, and we had to have that on our lapels for the 6 years I was there. Of course, on the last day, we all made them disappear, much to my regret now. I wish I could find them later. That little school symbol that we all carry with us, but they are nowhere to be found. But such is the nature of what's happening in our part of the world that nowadays the Pan Cyprian Gymnasium has something like 90% non-Cypriots and about 10% Cypriots, and unfortunately. But anyway, we're trying to revive it one way or another. Okay, but now the talk today is about Greece rather than Cyprus, although I will bring Cyprus in actually later on because there is a very interesting comparison that can be made. Now, I read a lot about the origins of the Greek crisis, and there are many people who believe, and they're still saying, "Oh, you know, it's all because the Greeks are lazy, or because they don't like paying taxes, or anything." As if anyone likes paying taxes, but anyway, that's a different issue, and so forth. And that's why they have problems. I think that's all nonsense. Actually, I think it's if you really want to understand the origins of the Greek crisis, which I think is important, that if you're to understand. That you need to understand the origins of the Greek crisis to see how we got to this point. And especially the reason for knowing how we got to this point is to know how to deal with it, how to move forward, because that's what matters now for Greece, is that you really have to go back even 50 years or something. And what, in my view, was probably the most destructive period in Greek history, which was the period of the civil war that followed German occupation, the World War, because when the big allies, Soviet Union and Roosevelt Churchill, you know, the Western allies, decided to split Europe into two camps, they left Greece out, and I think that's basically the source of the problem with Greece, because it was a destructive civil war for 3 years, the communists and the Western forces. And when the communists were defeated, and they were all expelled from Greece. And then that's when the favoritism started. They created a huge public sector controlled by the army. Everyone who fought on the winning side in the civil war got jobs in the civil service. Favoritism happened. There was no democracy for 20 years. Then, when democracy threatened to control Greek politics, the military staged a coup, destructive. They destroyed the country. They destroyed Cyprus in 1974. They threw Cyprus into the arms of Turkey, basically, with the behavior. And then after that, when all the Western campus where decided something had to be done, they said, well, what can we do with Greece? Having passed all the legislation to protect all those who were on the winning political side and to give them public sector jobs and protect their businesses and everything, what do we do with Greece? Well, let's put it into the European Union because this will guarantee democracy. They said, and that's how Greece got into the European Union. There was no effort to do a kind of due diligence on the economy. Is that economy capable of standing up to competition in a single market? Nothing at all. It was just a political decision. It was driven by one of the greatest Greek politicians of the 20th century, Karamanlis, with a Turkish name, of course, but that's besides the issue. And he was accepted in because he was thought that it was a way of securing democracy. But then what happens next? As soon as you have democratic elections in Greece, something very similar to what we're seeing today happened. The left wins the elections. And then they said, you know, for the last 30, 40 years, the right has been putting people into all positions of influence. So now we're going to do it. And the Papandreou regime came in the early 80s. You know, probably one of the most distinguished Greek economists, actually. He was a Professor Alberto everything, but he forgot all his economics when he got the job. He decided it was time to take revenge. And then the public sector expanded twice as big as before, because now you have to put in the left wingers in addition to the right wingers. And that's where we are today. And then that was 80s. Greece was growing through transfers directly from the European Union, mainly of foreign investments, nothing to do with increasing the competitiveness of the economy or making it, bringing it up to date with the rest of Europe. And then what happens when the next stage of European integration comes along, which is the euro? Well, Greek inflation was very high, so they are massive, so obviously couldn't be admitted into the euro. Greek debt was too high to be admitted into the euro. But then big efforts to bring inflation down temporarily through various tricks. And of course, the reason for that is that the way we measure inflation for the sake of policy is not what economists mean by inflation. In every economic student, when asked, you know, what's the difference between inflation and the price level, they will say inflation is a persistent and recurring change in prices, whereas the price level is something that is the level of price we pay, and then it might change once from one year to the next, but then that's not inflation. But in practice, we call inflation the change in the price level from one year to the next. So what Greece succeeded in doing in 1999 was to make sure that the price level that one year changed by less than 3%, and therefore it satisfied the main master criteria and got into the euro. They falsified some of the other data on debt, as they admitted later on, and they got into the euro. Again, no reform about anything. The economy was not prepared to face competition in the euro. So what happens in the euro? Well, what happens when you're within the euro, you suddenly discover that there is almost an unlimited supply of funds to you at German interest rates in a currency that you cannot depreciate it, whatever you did to it, because you are only 3% of the whole structure. And that's what they did. They borrowed and borrowed. And then it's all very well to borrow if you can invest. But the economy was still overprotected. There was still no competition to force competitive investment of one company against another. In fact, Greece, even today, Greece is the most heavily monopolized country in Europe. Almost every sector of the economy is controlled either by one or two big companies. That's with the exception of shipping, and that's the one thing that Greece is doing exceptionally well, but shipping doesn't come under Greek law. In fact, Greek ship owners are based in London and elsewhere. They do help the country actually a lot, but not by establishing their companies. You know, it's English law that mainly guides Greek shipping. And no incentive to invest in new technology. You get lots of cheap finance. What do you do with it? Well, you consume it. You know, I mean, even as economists, we say that the ultimate objective of production is consumption. we never say the ultimate objective of borrowing is consumption. But that's the issue. Maybe someone should tell the Chinese, actually, that the ultimate objective of production is consumption. It's the mainland Chinese, I mean. Because I've just come from mainland China, where they still don't seem capable to consume what they produce. But anyway, that's a different, completely different issue. So then you have the period in the euro from 2000 to 2008, where there is borrowing and spending and continuing borrowing. And if you talk to Greek politicians now, they will tell you that the reason we got to this crisis is the fault of the bankers. They do have a point, actually, because no major bank, no lender during that time realized that there was such a thing as a sovereign risk within the Eurozone. They thought for some reason that one country was going to bail out the other if necessary. They thought that by lending anyone in the Eurozone, they were lending the Eurozone as a whole, which of course is complete nonsense. It's quite astonishing how experienced bankers would make that mistake. And I say that because there is nothing. In fact, the Maastricht Treaty doesn't allow bailing out of one country by another explicitly. But also, even if the euro area was a federal area, there is no federal state in the world where one state can bail out another state. You know, if California went bankrupt, New York is not going to give it money. The Constitution, you know, maybe the federal government will help indirectly in some ways, but not by paying their debts. Federal Germany, you know, if one federal state needs money, another state is not going to give it money. These things are not allowed in constitutions, and yet European bankers were lending Greece endlessly at German interest rates. So 2008, the crisis comes, and suddenly they realize that there is such a thing as sovereign risk. They realize that they may not get their money back because their money was consumed. It wasn't invested. There was no rate of return on that money. So what happens after that? Well, Greece obviously goes to the rest of the Eurozone and says, we don't have any money to pay for the debt. What do we do? And the next mistake came along, which again, they temporarily gave some support to Greece in 2010 to pay for debts, but of course that doesn't help in any way. It just saw them through to 2012. And in 2012, they decided to forgive some of the debt to Greece, something like 60% was ignored, so the famous haircut. But again, that was a complete shambles, the way it was done, because they said to them, okay, you know, you don't have to pay 60% of your debt, but then they did absolutely nothing to stop subsequent lending other than imposing extreme austerity onto the country. But if you don't produce, then how do you make money to repay your debts? You don't. And not only that, also the forecast by the IMF especially and others were completely wrong as to what the reaction of the country would be to austerity, which was that there was going to be some recession, obviously, but not very much. But what they miscalculated very badly was the extent to which fiscal contraction has an impact on the economy. And of course, the reason for that, if you ask them now, the IMF, I did talk actually to a former, was he a chief economist? I'm not sure. Maybe he was a chief economist of the IMF at the time. He said what they mainly got wrong at the IMF was that they thought the rest of Europe was going to be growing and therefore Greece could export to the rest of Europe, but of course the rest of Europe went into recession as well. And but then they also admitted that they miscalculated some of what you might call the fiscal multipliers. But I think the main reason for that is the training, is the economics training that the economists who work at the IMF get. They all go to Chicago. What do you expect? They tell you that the fiscal multiplier is zero. In Greece, it was something like 1.5 or something, you know, minus. Therefore, you multiply everything by 1.5 when it was zero. Now, of course, one person who does understand all that was Olivier Blanchard, but he became chief economist after this. Miscalculations were happening. In fact, the documents that you may have seen from the IMF saying how they got it wrong on Greece and they should be rethinking the way that fiscal contraction impacts on the economy is due to Olivier Blanchard writing at the time. The result of all that, though, was that Greece was left with a debt of 170%, which obviously cannot pay. And reforms still haven't taken place. Now, let me give you a brief comparison. Actually, what time are we finishing completely? It's now 1:05. What time is everyone getting up and leaving?
Before two.
Oh, right. No. Now, it's quite interesting, actually, to compare here how the Troika, the international lenders, dealt with Greece on the one hand, and how they dealt with Cyprus on the other hand, because Cyprus faced similar problems about 1 or 2 years after Greece, and in fact, to a very large extent, it was due to Greece, in fact, that they faced those problems, because when international banks, especially Deutsche Bank and Paribas, realized that they were running serious sovereign risks with Greece, what they tried to do was get rid of their Greek bonds. Now, of course, no one wanted to buy Greek bonds except for the extremely clever Cyprus banks, because they thought they were helping the mother country. So, I mean, like, you know, there was a lot of pressure from the Greek central bank onto Cyprus banks to buy those bonds. In 2011, when all this was happening, I gave a lecture in Athens, which was sponsored by the Bank of Cyprus. And I was sitting with the CEO of the Bank of Cyprus, who is now wanted for questioning, by the way, by the Cyprus authorities, but he lives in Greece. And he was telling me confidentially, sort of quietly at the dinner table, how he said, we're buying loads and loads of Greek bonds, he said, from Deutsche Bank. And the governor of the central bank is so happy that we are doing it. He's going to give us licenses to operate throughout Greece now. In a few years' time, we're going to dominate the entire Greek banking market, he said to me. Now, of course, what happened a year later, those bonds lost their value entirely, and then Cyprus banks went down. So Cyprus then went to the international lenders to say that the banks were completely bankrupt and they needed to recapitalize them because the government couldn't recapitalize them. Now, Cyprus needed, altogether, they needed money that came to about 120% of GDP. And it had a debt of about 60%. So if they lent the money through the Troika to Cyprus, the way they did with Greece, Cyprus would have had now 170% debt. So it would be in the same situation as Greece is today. But in fact, to avoid that problem, because they saw it happening, what they did in Cyprus was that they closed the banks on a Friday, when the Eurogroup meeting was a Friday evening, all night. The banks were closed when the president and the finance minister went to Brussels to discuss what would happen, and next morning, they said to them, there's no way you'll fund the money. Either your banks will go bankrupt or take the money, half the money that you need from depositors. And there was nothing else they could do. On Monday, they said they had to do it. And that's the famous bail-in, that you take money from deposits in the bank to recapitalize the bank. I regret to say I was one of the depositors in the famous Bank of Cyprus, which was even reported in the newspaper. They said, what kind of Nobel Prize did he get? He doesn't even have the sense not to deposit his money in a bankrupt bank. Well, what can you do? Now, what was the outcome of that? Well, of course, the outcome of that was that Cyprus debt never exploded. I mean, even now, Cyprus debt is about 100%, and the economy is recovering because it was very quick to restore the fiscal finances. I mean, Cyprus economy is kind of bureaucratic and protective, but not to the extent that the Greek economy is. The Russian investors didn't leave. In fact, far from that, lots more tourists came from Russia. So there was a bit of a very large flow of money coming from Russia. Cyprus made good use of the drop in the price of oil by cutting down the price of energy. And you have an economy now recovering. It's a kind of shop window, in fact, for the Eurogroup. They're saying, you know, look how quickly Cyprus has come through. Which opens up, and like GDP in Cyprus came down by something like 8%, Greece by 25%, unemployment in Cyprus went up to 16%, in Greece it went up to 30%. So now there is always the issue of is a bail-in better than a bail-out? You know, I mean, if a bank needs recapitalization, should you be taking money from depositors? Or should you be lent the money? And but I would say that if you look at it from a purely economic point of view, lending the money means that you're taking it from taxpayers, and it's a socially more fair way of doing it. You know, in Cyprus, it was complete shock. I mean, you know, it's all very well people like me losing a little bit of money because we have money both in two countries, as it were, but there were people who had their entire life savings in the bank. You know, people in their 60s, 70s, financing their retirement out of that because there were no pensions, people saving money to send their children abroad to study in education, and suddenly they lost everything. And you had these sad stories on TV, people crying, saying, I worked for 40 years, I made half a million euros or a million euros in the bank for the rest of my life. How do I live now? You know, like, and there was nothing, you know, no answer. So socially, it's a terrible, terrible and unjust policy. But in terms of the macro situation, of course, it had a beneficial impact on the economy. It was just very cruel. But today, the EU is saying that it will never happen again, because if they say that bail-in is a possibility, then people will not deposit their money there. But they're also saying that there should be no haircuts. So it's interesting to see what will happen. Now then, you might say, let's switch back to Greece. You might say, well, what happened after that? Well, after that, they said what Greece needs is a program of adjustment. And they had one after that, and this only just had program number three now. What the program of adjustment does is severe fiscal austerity. You know, taxes up, government spending down, civil service pay cut to very low, dismissals, and so on. And at the same time, they're saying that reform should be imposed to open up the economy to competition. And the two together will succeed in restoring the economy. The impact, however, of all that was that many reforms have passed, but they're not being implemented, because to implement a reform, you need to have an incentive to do it. And when the economy is operating at such low level of activity, there's just no incentive to do anything. And investment collapsed completely. There are no investments taking place. And one thing that succeeded from the Troika's point of view was a cut in wages and labor costs, which they said was going to bring beneficial results. But I can show you, just break the monotony of the talk as well, I can show you, if you can pull up, is there a screen there? Yeah, there is. What happened? I mean, you can see here what happened to real earnings. I mean, in the years since the crisis started in 2009, these are all the countries that got sort of from European lenders. Well, Greece is the only one where real incomes came down by 20%. And that's average. This is average real incomes, by the way. It's not public sector real incomes or anything. You know, Spain, they came down with 7%. Ireland, more or less nothing. Italy, nothing. Portugal, another 7%. But Greece, 20%. Now, that was reflected in labor costs as well. And I'm going to say something later on, that unit labor costs in Greece came down by 20% in 3 years. It's unprecedented, actually, that kind of change. But then look what happened to investment. This is private investment. I mean, Greece had a respectable private investment of about 23%. After the haircut and the crisis, investment went down to just over 10%. In Ireland, of course, it collapsed at the time as well. That's mainly because of construction investment that was so big in Ireland. But if you look at US and the EU as a whole, the impact was much less than on the program countries, which is telling you that there's something wrong with the program when it's hitting investment so hard. And that's private investment. If you look at public investment, which is mainly infrastructure, that's even worse. I mean, like, I was at a talk that Larry Summers gave. It was a meeting of the annual meetings of the European Central Bank. And he gave a talk about the cost of borrowing money in the States, which is zero practically for the government. And he was saying how terrible the government is that it's not borrowing money to have infrastructure investments now that the cost is zero and it's not helping the United States to recover. And then by coincidence, I was giving a talk on investment in Europe, and I showed this table here, which, I mean, you can see what's happening in the United States. It came down from 3.7 to 3.6. In the European Union as a whole, it came down from 2.5 to about 2.4. But in countries like Greece, it came down from close to 3.5 to 1.7. And if Americans are complaining that what's happening to the United States in present financial conditions is terrible, when you look at the graph, I mean, what can Europeans, what can we poor Europeans say about it? I mean, the situation is really dire as far as public investment goes in providing the infrastructure necessary for development and then private investment supporting it. So something obviously needs to be done. Now, what's the response of the international lenders to this kind of situation? Were they, let me, to give you a response to that, let me first backtrack a little bit and think what, if you give these numbers to an economist and you tell them it's an open economy, open to international trade, what would you expect to see? The immediate answer is that I expect to see a massive depreciation of the exchange rate. Massive depreciation of the exchange rate will create incentives for exports, investment incentives, and they will happen. But then if you tell them, well, for some reason, you know, forget why, the exchange rate is fixed, you cannot change the exchange rate, then what will happen? Well, then we're on to what's known in the literature as the optimal currency area, the sort of Mandel, Fleming kind of contributions. And then the answer is that, okay, there's one of three things will happen. The first one is migration. People leave the country until you restore productivity. Now, this is not happening in Europe because Europeans like to live in the country they were born, most of them, and there is enough support. The standard of living is sufficiently high that it doesn't push them away. Some migration is happening, especially young people not returning to the country if they're studying abroad or something, but not to a very large scale. The second one is a fiscal transfer. Your partners just bail you out. They give you the money, you invest it, and the economy grows. Well, this is not allowed in the European Union. As I was saying, it's not even certain that it should be. But some money is given by Central European funds, especially the European Stability Mechanism, as it's known. It's got something like 500 billion euros to distribute. But then the third one, which is the one that is being promoted a lot by international lenders, is what's known as internal depreciation, which is the idea that if your internal costs fall, then your goods will still be very competitive in international markets, and therefore that's equivalent to a depreciation of the currency. On paper it is, you know, if you look at an economic textbook, it will say that yes, this is the right answer, especially sort of neoclassical economic textbooks, the kind we teach nowadays our students. And more practically, in the case of Greece, in fact, it was told even to me by people of the Troika, because I do have the good or bad fortune to meet them occasionally when they come to Cyprus especially, is they say, you know, think of tourism. If you cut the costs of tourism by 20%, like that cut in wages, then obviously you're going to get more tourists and that will see you out of recession. Well, there's a limit to how many tourists you can have in a place, you know. It's a small sector. I mean, it might be a big export sector, but it's still small compared with the rest of the economy. The bulk of the economy is retailing. It's what people buy in the shops. You know, that takes about 60% of the economy or something. Tourism might be 10, 15% of the economy. That's what people don't realize. The biggest part of the economy that drives economic recovery is domestic consumption. If people in your domestic economy don't want to consume, there's nothing you can do to bring the economy up. But anyway, that's a different issue. So it's the internal depreciation. Now, internal depreciation was forced on these countries. Now, how do you make... Now, internal depreciation means that you reduce labor costs. To reduce labor costs, you need to cut wages. And I show that in the case of Greece, they cut them by 20%. How do you force workers to take less pay? In a decentralized capitalist economy, you cannot do these things. You know, it's not, I mean, there's no dictator who will say you'll be paid less. It has to be a market outcome. And we know that for that to be a market outcome, you have to have some worse alternative if you don't take a pay cut. And of course, the worst alternative in the case of wages is unemployment. So the only way to cut wages is unemployment. That somehow escaped them when they designed the program. So you can see in red the countries that had to do the internal depreciation. I mean, look at how their unemployment shot up. Spain, Greece, by... These are additional points of unemployment to force the wage reductions. And at least in Greece, they forced the wage reductions. In Spain, they didn't. And Cyprus, Ireland, are the countries that had the biggest rise in unemployment. Okay, so you get unemployment up to those levels. You get wages down. and they succeed. You know, the unemployment succeeds in bringing wages down. But then again, for people to buy your product, they pay prices, they don't pay wages. So now, did prices fall? Well, no, prices didn't. Prices fell by something like 2 or 3%. And you might say, why? Well, because what they hadn't realized as well in these programs is that most of the prices that Greeks use as inputs are foreign prices. They import the goods. They don't produce any manufacturing goods. You buy abroad, you bring the goods here, you mix them with your domestic labor, and you sell. So prices depend on foreign prices that didn't come down. And the other big fault of the Greek economy, that is a monopolized economy, and the monopolist doesn't reduce its prices easily. It's not free market competition. So some profit margins have actually increased because of this this change. Okay, so you're now in a situation where prices don't fall by very much, labor costs fall a lot, unemployment goes up a lot, fiscal spending is down a lot. So what's the impact on the economy? Does it become more competitive? Does it sell more? In fact, no, it's exactly the opposite happens. The economy just goes down and down in a spiral because you need to have a budget surplus to pay for the debt, but if the economy is going down and if you have high unemployment, you have a budget deficit, you cannot repay, the Troika comes in and forces you on another program of adjustment, and so on and so forth. So what we are seeing here, which is very interesting from the economist point of view, is a kind of rebirth of old-fashioned Keynesian economics that essentially economic activity in this case is driven by aggregate demand, and what the various adjustment programs are doing is that they are restricting aggregate demand, and therefore they are making situation worse. You know, they are the negative multipliers that the IMF missed at the time. So if you look at the problem there, would you then say, well, the problem with Greece is in the labor market? Well, it isn't. You know, like the labor market is not by any stretch of the imagination perfect. In fact, it's got many defects, but it's not the reason that the country is going through this from crisis to crisis. And the same is true of Europe. A lot of the European labor markets have become inflexible. A lot of them need reform. The UK, Netherlands, Germany have reformed successfully over the last 30 years. Many other countries, especially in this house, didn't. Spain reformed something like 5 years ago, but it still has about 25% unemployment. These things take time to have an impact. It's something it should be a long-term target within Europe. You know, Greece shouldn't have been admitted into the European Union in the single market without an agreement on some labor market reforms, like mistakes being made at the time. But it's not something that you're in a recession, in a big crisis, and then you say, reform your labor market, and it's going to take you out of crisis. It's absurd. You know, it's ridiculous to say to insist something like that. The reason that we are where we are is that there is catastrophic fall in investment, catastrophic fall in government spending, fall in people's incomes. They are not spending. And you essentially have an economy that was operating somewhere up here and is now operating down here. It's a complete sort of leap. If there are reforms that are more urgent, those are in product markets. You need to break up monopolies. Monopolies are not good for any economy, and Greece has more than any other. You need to create a more favorable investment environment. You know, like in the rankings for doing business, Greece is one of the lowest in Europe. The lowest are Russia, Greece, Bulgaria, and Cyprus. But the whole of Europe is facing the same problem. And you can see that here, in fact, when it comes to new technology. You do need R&D to the new technology. You can see how Europe is still behind USA, Japan. It's well behind South Korea, actually. I should have put South Korea figures here as well. China is catching up. I bet you anything in 2 years' time, China will be ahead of all those on R&D because they're putting more and more money into R&D. The only country of the major countries, because I didn't look at the smaller countries in Europe, the only major country in Europe that is doing R&D to justify the new technology, justify growth, is Germany, whereas you can see it's even doing more than the United States. Spending more on higher education and government-supported R&D as well as business. And you can see that in the industrial successes of Germany. But Europe as a whole is well below Germany. And of course, you know, Germany is included in EU 28, so you can imagine what the others are doing. That's where most of the needs are. This is where that's why you need to free the markets to move forward. So given where we are, where I hope you're getting my message, is that the Greek crisis was completely mishandled. Greeks have made mistakes. International lenders made mistakes. We got to where we are. Now, what is this telling us about the future of Europe now? Some remarks about that before I open up to questions. Well, the question is that do the Eurozone countries now have the political will to cooperate together to restore economic balance within the Euro area? Decisions are still not reached in a consistent way. Even now, if you say, okay, there is a crisis, how are we going to reach a decision? We don't know. There will be big arguments. There will be all-night meetings. The last minute, you'll decide. I mean, it's quite ridiculous that in the case of Greece, the Greek bailout package depended critically on whether Schäuble or Varoufakis was going to be the first one to blink in Eurozone, in Eurogroup meetings. I mean, Varoufakis keep it, you know, like, I won't make any comments about him. He's the former finance minister of Greece, but he's now onto the lecture circuit going around his experience, and he said all-night meetings, and I would stare at Schäuble, and if he moved his head yes, then it means we won. If it was no, we lost. Well, in fact, in the end, he lost, of course, and now he's only because he's so bitter that he goes around saying things that he does. But the idea, more generalized, though, the idea that the decision depends on whether one or the other would be the first one to say, okay, you know, I pull out when you are on the brink. It's not a way to reach decisions within a cooperative manner. You know, Greece didn't leave the euro because it was to no one's interest to leave the euro. And at the time, Varoufakis was pretending that Greece was going to leave and they were better off, but he never intended to leave the euro, and Schäuble knew it very well. So why should he be the first one to blink? I mean, he's not stupid. Anything but. What the Greek crisis, though, has brought to Europe, which is not good for Europe, is that it heightened this conflict between my country's interest and Europe's interest. When the financial crisis first started in 2008 and up to 2012, the key word in Europe was that we're in it together and we need solidarity, and there is solidarity expressed by all members of the European Union, and we're moving together. The word solidarity, if you do a search on the word solidarity from the website of the European Commission of 2011-12, you see it in almost every speech. After 2012-13, the word doesn't appear at all. The word that you'll find more and more frequent is my voters' interests. So now what you hear in Europe more and more is that it's not Europe's problem, it's your country's problem. You hear that being said a lot. And another thing that you hear being said is that I'd love to help, but my voters wouldn't let me. I heard the latter. I love to help, but my voters wouldn't help me. It was said in last January when the World Economic Forum meetings were taking place. It coincided. It was the very week of the Greek elections when Tsipras was first elected, and the Finnish Prime Minister at the time was there, and he said exactly what I said to you, word for word. He said, you know, we all want to help Greece. And of course, I mentioned Finland because they were the ones that objected most to a bailout agreement. He said, we'd love to help to the extent we can as a small country, but our voters will not help us. And the reason they elected us was for the interests of our own country, not other countries in the Union, at our cost. The statement is your country's problem and not mine. I was saying that sooner or later, Germany might not want to hear that, I was saying, and people were laughing when I mentioned it in a meeting about 2 months ago. I mean, I used Germany as an example, but I meant any other European country. Because it was said to the Greeks that it's your problem, not Europe's problem, so sort yourself out. And I said it might come, and they were saying, well, when would it come? Well, it came with the migration crisis, in fact, when the president of Hungary said to, at the European meetings, he said, my migration crisis, war crisis is not our problem, it's Germany's, because that's where all the migrants want to go. And he went and, and he went and erected a fence to stop migrants from coming into his country. And even now, in fact, the migration crisis is giving you a very good example of how the whole union works post-Greek crisis. The way they are working now and the way they are reaching an agreement reflects exactly the way they were doing it over Greece. Some countries were sympathizing, some were not. They were saying it's a Greek problem. Others were saying my voters won't let me do it. And they're doing the same with migration crisis now. They're saying they want to go to the big countries. They want to go to Germany. Britain is saying it's not my problem. I've got a sea between continental Europe and my island, and they don't get onto ships. And problem finished. France is saying they don't have the capacity. They're all landing on Greek islands, and what's Greece going to do with the 250,000 Syrians on the islands? You know, give it another month, and there will be no one left on the islands, not Syrians. And the problem goes on and on. And of course, it's ongoing. You know, like they have an emergency meeting next week to decide what they're going to do with the immigrants. You know, Croatia said Greece should get its act together and deal with the immigrants. I mean, why? You know, it's one of the poorest countries in the Union just because it happened to be the one closest to Syria. It's Greece's problem now. It's not anyone else. You know, and so what's the future going to bring? Well, we obviously need, something needs to change if the continent as a whole is going to grow by more than the 0.1 or whatever is forecast, or 1% or whatever is forecast now. The United States is growing at 3%, China at 7%, whatever. In fact, all the blocks, even Japan is growing faster than Europe now. The way to describe the policy now that I've seen in some American publications, but it's quite good, I think, is kicking the can down the road. And this, as Wolfgang Munchau in the Financial Times said, in the case of the immigration crisis, they're kicking people down the road, unfortunately, not just cans. It's not a way to carry on. There's hope dominates action now. You do it, and then you're hoping that things will improve. But then the next crisis comes along. In my view, they should decide that they need more integration, or they might as well go back to having an economic union without any political or common monetary policy. You know, dismantle it peacefully if you cannot make it function. Britain is very close to exiting the European Union, in fact, with all these new things happening there. The new Labour leader is not, new Labour Party elections are not going to help very much. I don't think Cameron has much credibility now in Britain as far as reforming. You know, he wants to reform the European Union. You know, as if the European Union doesn't have its own problems, but he has to reform the wishes of Mr. Cameron so he can recommend his voters to vote for. He wants to stay in anyway, so they all know that. But something needs to be done there as well. So this is where we are. With this happy note, I end.
Yeah. So why don't we open it up directly for questions and Q&A for a while. Yes, please, over here. Maybe introduce yourself and your affiliation.
I'm Patrick Sandon. Actually, I worked at BNP Paribas many years ago during the
Oops.
I've been based in Asia many years, and I'm an independent director of the Maybank Group, so I'm very interested in what you're speaking about and the implications for other emerging markets, whether we call Greece an emerging market or not.
Yeah.
But relevant to that is Greece joining and the crisis. You described in very good story about how Greece was never ready. And Europe knew it was not ready, but it was a political decision. Mm-hmm. And one thing which strikes me is political governance was very, very weak and was known throughout and was never reformed, even post-Euro. And if I look at it now, what do you think about political governance, both at the domestic level? Everyone talks about European Union integration, but at the domestic level of the weaker countries, because I see a high correlation in Europe and globally between political and perhaps corporate governance, but political governance and economic growth, etc. And that was worries me now when I look at Europe and European Union and the weaker members versus the stronger members. What are your comments on that, please?
No, I agree that I'm very concerned about it myself, about the political governance and the ability of the government to pass difficult legislation and implement it. That's especially in the implementation, because passing it, you could manage to pass laws one way or another, but implementing it down to the ground is difficult when you have to go through so many layers, and when all those layers were political appointments. And in countries like Greece, the political appointments go all the way down to the receptionist in ministries. You know, when a new government comes in, they will do it, See, people many times draw a parallel between political governance in Hong Kong and Cyprus because we were both British colonies. But in fact, Cyprus kept to those traditions for about 10 years, and then they started learning from their Greek brethren. And they're doing exactly the same. I can see it. You know, if someone is a party member and the party is in power, they're much more likely to get a job, even if their job is to be a driver in a ministry. And that happens. The implementation of policy there is not good. When it's not very encouraging, at least, that there will be implementation if the government doesn't agree with the policy. So talking about political governance in the case of Greece, for example, more specifically, you know, the fact that Tsipras said before the election that he's going to sign and he will try and pass the new program requirements and do them, although he doesn't agree with them, and although this and although that. And then he gets elected. I'm very pessimistic about his ability to implement them, because those who voted for him in the party, they will say, you know, why should I do this in some ministry, in some office in a ministry? The prime minister himself doesn't believe it just because he was forced to sign. You know, so that is, I think it's one of the biggest issues that you identified as to how you reform a public sector to implement, and I think that's going to be the most difficult part of reform as well, if it ever happens. Doesn't know how you deal with it.
So right here.
Thank you for the informative talk. I'm a Hong Kong University MBA alumni. My question is, because Professor, you start by saying that Greece being lazy and tax evasion is nonsense. I think this kind of thinking comes probably from Michael Lewis. And then, if you type, say, tax evasion in Greece, there are plenty of news coming up in this topic as well, saying that the informal economy of Greece probably takes about 20-25% of GDP, and tax evasion is like close to 90% of the actual tax revenue. So,
but tax evasion is 90% of tax
revenue.
Yeah.
So they only pay 10% of what they should pay. It comes from BBC, actually. Yeah. Anyway, my question is, why do you think tax evasion probably is not a huge issue there, or is there anything that we should know about tax evasion issue in Greece, or how they should tackle these kind of things in Greece?
Well, you know, like, There are two ways of looking at it. Actually, one is the kind of social justice dimension that principles of optimal taxation is that there's got to be some justice, some redistribution, some progressivity. You know, you pay according to ability and all that. So an issue of tax evasion is whether by avoiding to pay tax, you don't fulfill those objectives of the taxation. It's a very unfair taxation system. In the case of Greece, that probably is because it's the wealthy people who avoid the tax through bribes mainly. You know, you pay some official a bribe, which is less than much less than the tax that you own. But then there's another way of looking at that tax evasion, which is the one I was referring to here, which is the more macro way. You know, the social justice aspect is a micro way of looking at it. The macro way is to see how much revenue there is as a percentage of GDP. How much revenue does the government get in and how much it spends? And Greece is not any worse off than other countries in that respect. In fact, it probably has a bigger tax revenue than the United States, say, or you know, Britain does have a high one, actually. I'm sure it has a lot more than Hong Kong, for example, of tax revenue. So they do manage to raise the money. And of course, but then the biggest earner is VAT. And that's why the Troika is always insisting that they should put VAT up more and more, because you cannot, you know, you might avoid VAT on a one-to-one, you know, if a plumber comes home to do a job for you, you don't pay VAT. You don't pay it in England anyway, you know, if a plumber comes home. But in most cases, I mean, there's a tax evasion there in the construction sector. But then all the big shops and the ones that have to issue receipts and all that, they have to have VAT, and that's where the collection is. So although tax evasion, the way I look at it is that it's more of a social problem. I don't think it's the big economic problem, given that the government is raising the revenue. And when I say social problem, there are people who like our ambassador here, who I'm sure he pays much more than his fair share, because he cannot hide it anywhere. Even, not that he would want to, of course, but just in case. You know, I mean, in other words, people who have, sorry, in your university, you know, my university colleagues in Athens, they are all looking for jobs elsewhere because their tax rates are so high, they've got almost no money to take home anymore. But that's the social aspect of it that I was referring to, yeah.
Yes.
Sir, are you optimistic about the Greek crisis yourself? Will it be over in, say, 2 to 3 years, just like Iceland, and now the Ireland also on the way to be a healthy country? Do you see it that way?
No.
Thank you.
No, I'm a little bit more optimistic than I was before. In January and February, I was very, very pessimistic because of what the Greek government was saying. And in fact, at that time, I remember having meetings in London, and I was saying the only way forward for the country is for the new prime minister, the then new prime minister in January, February, to sign the agreement for the third memorandum, because it was the only way you could ensure that Greece stayed in the euro, but then resign and say that there will be elections because you elected me on the promise that I wouldn't sign. Now that I see reality, there is nothing else I can do, because 75% of you want to stay in the euro. Sign, resigning, and then say, elect me to run the program. It's exactly what happened 7 months later. So I'm more optimistic now. You know, he should have done it in February and not in August, September, whenever he resigned. But the outcome was good, not because I feel that they would do a better job than the other party. It's good in that there's going to be a stable government for the next 4 years. So at least, you know, political governance will not be perfect for the reason we were saying before, but at least there will be no more elections. And people are fed up with elections. Only just over half turned up to vote in Greece. They just got fed up. So that makes me more optimistic. It makes me more optimistic, but at least they are paying lip service that they will implement the program. But Greece cannot be like Ireland or Iceland in 3 years' time. In fact, Iceland is a bit peculiar because they took the money. It's a little bit of the Cyprus problem. They took the money from foreigners instead of domestic people. Greece cannot do it because the foreigners are Europeans. Most of the foreigners who lent Greece money are Europeans. And you cannot do it by Eurozone rules. But Ireland had the big advantage that it already had one of the most flexible and efficient labor markets, with lots of foreign investment and high technology. So where they went wrong was in the banking system, in the construction sector. So once they fixed those two, then the economy will grow, whereas Greece needs to reform its economy to get to the point of Ireland. And even if it reformed today, you will see results in about 4 years. It's what happened in Germany, for example. It reformed, started reforming in 2002, 2005, and it started seeing results in 2007. And the rest of Europe was growing at the time, and Germany had budget deficits to finance this reconstruction effort of more than 3%. That's when they broke the Maastricht rules for this reason, to finance the reconstruction. It was more or less more like 4 or 5%. I don't know if it went to 5, actually. And it still took 4 years. So if you ask me, if everything goes well, you know, the most positive scenario, give Greece 7 years to start growing robustly, but that's the more positive scenario.
I'm Sasi Gopalan from IEMS. I'm a postdoctoral fellow here. Quick question. Most of the popular narrative that you hear about Greece and the problem is all about what Greece can do in terms of debt reduction, structural reforms, and all that. But how much do you think that Germany can actually contribute to this resolution of the problem, in terms of especially considering that the current account imbalances were the roots of the crisis and the massive capital flows that flowed in was largely because of Germany, cutting down of current account surpluses that Germany is running and acceptance of greater inflation. I mean, that always seems to be absent in the popular discourse, and I just wanted to know what your take is on it.
Yeah, actually, debt is something we haven't spoken about, actually, because I do think that there are too many issues in Greek debt that get confused. I mean, the figure 170% is unsustainable. Obviously, something needs to be done about it, but not for another 5 years because repayment terms are very, very favorable. And then as economists, we know that the way to measure debt is to take the present discounted value of future payments. If you do that, Greek debt is much less than 170. It's still high, but it could be dealt with just by extending the term or by cutting the interest rate beyond 2020, depending on where the interest rates are there. You know, maybe Janet Yellen will still be hesitating whether to raise rates by 2020. Who knows? Yeah. It might still be at 0%. But that's a completely different issue. Now the question of Germany, I think, it's obviously the core question in Europe. I look carefully at what Germany is doing, and they are doing the right things for their country. There's no doubt about that, given the demographics of the country and the industry of the country, and that's why you see the successes that you see. Where you might criticize Germany is that it's not doing more for Europe, given the problems of Europe. And that's why I said that there is a conflict of country versus Europe. You don't hear it so much now because of the responses of Schäuble, the finance minister, but a year ago there was strong pressure on him to increase public spending by 1% of German GDP because it was going to help the rest of the Eurozone. It was a small number for Germany, but it was going to be big for the small countries. And he insisted, and he said, why should I do it? He said, Europe has a common central bank, it has a common policy, it's independent, they can do what they want. He said, I don't like the QE that Draghi announced in January, but he's independent, he can do it. But fiscal policy is in national hands, and I'm not going to do it because it's not good for my country. I heard him myself say that, in fact, in an interview on CNBC in January. He even got excited, because I don't know if you've ever seen him talk in real life, but he gets excited very easily. Much David moving. But he's right for his own country. So that's the issue. I mean, I obviously don't know the answer to that. Like in the past, Germany did more under the big pro-European leaders because they were concerned to achieve European Union, under Helmut Schmidt, for example, under Kohl, they did a lot more than now. the present government obviously doesn't want to be associated with any breakup of Europe of any kind. They are pro-European, for sure. Especially Schäuble, actually, someone, a German economist who knows him personally, told me recently that he cares a lot more about European unity than what happens to the euro, the value of the euro. He thinks it's a small thing. But at the same time, at least, you know, I mean, if I wear my Greek hat, I would say that I'm obviously not doing enough. If I got my into German shoes, I would say, congratulations, fantastic. You've used your own comparative advantage and the associations with Europe to best advantage, you know, where you draw the line. I wish they would shift the line slightly in the direction of Europe, though, for the future of Europe. But it's obviously a political decision.
Maybe I can follow up with a question. And then, here, over here.
I'm Max Ma from Hong Kong. In 97, the Asian financial crisis, Korea, Indonesia, Thailand, all of these countries took a hit. Their currencies dropped by 50% or more. But subsequently, in the next few years, every one of them recovered. Now, if we look at the financial tsunami, Iceland took a hit at 73% of the currency hit, and then it also is recovering. Now, with Greece, it did not do that. And from 2008, when there was external debt of 100 billion euro, today it's expanded to over 300 billion euro. Why can't Greece just simply take a hit and leave the European community instead? Because this situation is probably going to come back again in 2 years' time. You know, maybe Germany would have to fit another bill of about another 100 to 200 billion dollar.
Well, it's going to be much worse off, actually, if it did that than if it reformed within the European community. I mean, when you say European community, you mean the Eurozone, not the European community. Yeah. Now, in the case of Greece, though, you also have to take into account who owns the debt that Greece has. And most of the debt now is owned by the European Stability Mechanism, and it's denoted in euros. And the IMF loan is denoted in euros. So if it were to leave the euro, it would have to default against its partners. Well, why would it want to do that? I mean, what future does it have if it does that?
Oh, well, I think if the currency drops, so example, just now you said you were discounting the fact that the tourism was not
Greek debt will not drop.
But they would need to have revenues. You know, if you depreciate your currency, you will have more revenues to pay for the taxes. Right now, if by raising tax, nobody's going to increase anymore, or at least fewer people is going to increase. So where are they going to get their revenue to pay to service the debts? Now, if you lower the currency, if they go back to the drachma, perhaps, you know.
But then the debt will be worth twice as much.
Well, let it be worth twice as much.
How are they going to get, I mean, if they go to the drachma,
they have a revenue come back, but right now it does not.
But they won't, because the currency will not be worth much. You're saying that depreciation, I mean, say, you know, reasonable estimates is that the new drachma will be worth half. You know, suppose they introduce a Greek euro, they call it drachma, but it's one-on-one. Then it will be worth half. Greek debts will remain as euro debts. Greece will have no money to pay for imports, civil servants, food will disappear from the shops, maybe olive oil, maybe olives not, but actually even olives, Greek olives are Italian now anyway.
But you know, what I'm saying is that there are examples to you know, Korea, Iceland.
Yeah, but it was different because they defaulted on their debts. They had the, wasn't the Brady plan or something, or was that Latin America? Yeah, but Greece doesn't have that. I mean, that's what they've been fighting on all this time. But debt also now is not the issue, you see, debt now. The issue now is money to revive the economy. You know, if you start printing money and giving it out for people to consume, you're going to create inflation. And you create inflation, and then in real terms, it will be worth nothing. You know, you cannot create real income by printing money. You know, I mean, the people, I mean, economists that I respect enormously, obviously, like Krugman and Stiglitz, are writing and they say Greece should leave. But the reason they're saying it is for Greece to have an independent monetary policy. But even they miss the point of who owns Greek debt. And if Greece could default on all its debts, you know, say I'm now outside the Eurozone, I have my own currency, and I'm not paying any euro-denominated debt, then, and it were to survive after that, okay, it would be better off instantly. No one will ever want to lend it money. It will become an outcast within the European Union. You know, forget it as a European country. And what future does it have? Go and form an alliance with Turkey or Syria? I mean, neighbors on the other side.
I don't know.
It has no future outside Europe.
But now it has no future either.
Well, now it has a future. You know, the fact that they signed, I mean, why would someone like Tsipras, a self-confessed communist who came there to fight Europe and Germany and the Troika, and everything. The only thing he succeeded was to rename the Troika into institution. Now they are called the institutions are visiting, not the Troika. That's his only success. I mean, he signed exactly the same as before because he realized that there's no future outside. And the sooner political leaders realize it, the better off the country will be. Because it needs to reform. That's why I took you briefly into that history, starting with the 1950s, because it's been going on for too long. You know, the country's just got into this situation that it just cannot get out. It's like it's quicksand. It's been sinking and sinking and sinking through these political problems that it had and everything. And now it cannot be pulled out easy, and unless political leaders realize it, then they do it. You know, you need someone tough. Yeah, he might still do it, actually, the new prime minister, because he's proving to be tougher than, or at least he's proving flexible to change his mind, in contrast to his finance minister, who's gone completely gaga as a young man. The things he's saying.
Thank you. I'm sorry, at this point, given the time, I think we're going to end today's event, and I just want to first thank Sir Christopher for his very insightful comments. I think we've all gained a healthy appreciation for the complexity of the problems facing Greece and Europe. I'd also like to thank all of our staff at IEMS, Carla, and at LAPP for all the very hard work they did in organizing today's event. And on behalf of the three sponsors, HKUST IEMS, HKUSD, LAPP, and EY Hong Kong, I'd like to thank you all for coming today. Thank you very much.